Good morning.
Good morning.
Well, welcome to God's house this morning. It's good to be together as we gather to worship our Lord, to hear His word, and to sing His praise. And before we begin, just a reminder that our care cards are there in the pews in front of you in the racks. We just ask that you take those, both members and guests alike. Data, check any boxes that pertain for you, anything that you'd like to share with us. If you are a new guest with us or have in your own life maybe updated different phone numbers or emails, we appreciate your contact information. It helps us to communicate and serve as best as we can. We also have today, after worship, our little tutorial session for our revamping and reinventing the way that we do our script fundraising program. We've been sharing it for a couple of weeks in the announcement sheet. There's this information letter that's out there in the gathering area, and today we're going to do the tutorial. So right after worship, I'm really not going to spend much time greeting people, just going to take my robes off, get the computer set, and we're going to just walk people through and answer questions about how this is a different way of doing script. And if you have questions, please stay and watch. And it won't be long, and hopefully we'll answer your questions and show you exactly how to do that program. That's it for those kinds of announcements. Our worship today, we're going to be focusing in on the gospel. It's a rather different story. It's a long story that Mark tells in sequence of what's happening in Jesus' life, but then he tells us of these flashbacks that this man by the name of Herod is having about something awfully extraordinary and evil that he did in his life. And so we're going to talk about that in this theme of leaving the hall of memories. And how do we do that in our own lives as well? And I invite you to sing with our opening hymn. It's number 915, Today Your Mercy Calls Us. invite you to stand as you are able, as we call on God's name that he lovingly puts on each of us in our baptism with his promise that we're his. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
And in the scriptures, John warns us, if we say that we have no sin, then we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us.
But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness.
And let us then confess our sins to God our Father.
Most merciful God, we confess that we are by nature sinful and unworthy. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed. By what we have done, and by what we have left undone, we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We justly deserve your present and eternal punishment. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, redeem us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways.
And upon your confession, I do have good news for you, that Almighty God in his mercy has given his only Son Jesus to die for you, and for his sake God forgives you all your sins. As pastor, it's my joy then to announce that grace of God to all of you, and in the stead and by the command of Jesus, to forgive you your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. In peace, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord. This holy house, and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord. Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord. Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on that may hurt us.
So that we, human individual, body and soul, may cheerfully accomplish whatever things you want done, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and rules with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Our Old Testament reading for this eighth Sunday after Pentecost is from the prophet Amos, the seventh chapter. It's a strong word of judgment and warning that Amos brings, and he uses a plumb line, a measuring tool of construction, to show how the people aren't measuring up. So this is what the Lord God showed me, Amos said. Behold, the Lord was standing beside a wall built with a plumb line, with a plumb line in his hand. And the Lord said to me, Amos, what do you see? And I said, a plumb line. Then the Lord said, behold, I am setting a plumb line in the midst of my people Israel. I will never again pass by them. The high places of Isaac shall be made desolate, and the sanctuaries of Israel shall be laid waste, and I will rise against the house of Jeroboam with the sword. Then Amaziah, the priest of Bethel, sent to Jeroboam, king of Israel, saying, Amos has conspired against you in the midst of the house of Israel. The land is not able to bear all his words, for thus Amos has said, Jeroboam shall die by the sword, and Israel must go into exile away from his land. And Amaziah said to Amos, O seer, go, flee away to the land of Judah and eat bread there and prophesy there, but never again prophesy at Bethel, for it is the king's sanctuary and it is a temple of the kingdom. Then Amos answered and said to Amaziah, I was no prophet nor a prophet's son, but I was a herdsman and a dresser of sycamore figs. But the Lord took me from following the flock, and the Lord said to me, go, prophesy to my people Israel. And this is the word of the Lord. And our epistle today is a reading from St. Paul's letter to the church in Ephesus, the Ephesians, and it's going to begin a number of weeks of a continual reading that we'll walk through this letter to the Ephesians. From chapter 1, Paul writes, Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in Christ with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places, even as he chose us in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and blameless before him. In love, he predestined us for our adoption as sons through Jesus Christ, according to the purpose of his will, to the praise of his glorious grace, with which he has blessed us in the Beloved. In him, we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of our trespasses, according to the riches of his grace, which he has lavished upon us in all wisdom and insight, making known to us the mystery of his will, according to his purpose, which he set forth in Christ as a plan for the fullness of time, to unite all things in him, things in heaven and things on earth. In him, in Jesus, we have obtained an inheritance, having been predestined according to the purpose of him who works all things according to the counsel of his will, so that we, who were the first to hope in Christ, might be to the praise of his glory. In him, you also, when you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, and believed in him, you were sealed with the promised Holy Spirit, who is the guarantee of our inheritance until we acquire possession of it, to the praise of his glory. This is the word of our Lord.
Thanks be to God.
And I invite you to stand as you are able for the reading of the gospel. According to St. Mark, the sixth chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
And the reading picks up from last week where Jesus was sending out his disciples in groups of two to announce his coming kingdom, to heal and to restore people. And Mark says, King Herod heard of that, for Jesus' name had become known. Some said John the Baptist has been raised from the dead, and that is why these miraculous powers are at work in him. But others said he's Elijah, and others even said he's a prophet, like one of the prophets of old. But when Herod heard of it, he said, John, whom I beheaded, has been raised. For it was Herod who had sent and seized John and bound him in prison for the sake of Herodias, his brother's Philip's wife, because he had married her. For John had been saying to Herod, it's not lawful for you to have your brother's wife. And Herodias had a grudge against John and wanted to put him to death. But she could not, for Herod feared John, knowing that he was a righteous and holy man, and he kept him safe. And when Herod heard him, he was greatly perplexed, and yet he heard him gladly. But an opportunity came when Herod, on his birthday, gave a banquet for his nobles and military commanders and the leading men of Galilee. For when Herodias' daughter came in and danced, she pleased Herod and his guests. And the king said to the girl, Ask me for whatever you wish, and I will give it to you. And he vowed to her, Whatever you ask me, I will give you up to half my kingdom. And she went out and said to her mother, For what should I ask? And she said, The head of John the Baptist. And she came in immediately with haste to the king and asked, saying, I want you to give me at once the head of John the Baptist on a platter. And the king was exceedingly sorry. But because of his oath and his guests, he did not want to break his word to her. And immediately the king sent an executioner with orders to bring John's head. He went and beheaded him in the prison and brought his head on a platter and gave it to the girl, and the girl gave it to her mother. And when his disciples heard of it, they came and took John's body and laid it in the tomb. This is the gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
And you may be seated. And I'd like to invite the kids to come up and join me for our kids' story. Good morning. How are you all doing? Good morning. You guys can sit right there so I can see you. Couple more friends are coming up. Good morning, good morning. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen, for coming up. So I just have something I want you to do. You can have a seat, girls. And I want you to do this. I want you to use your imaginations with me, okay? And everybody out, you can do this too, everybody else out there. So I want you to close your eyes. I want you to use your imagination. Imagine it's nighttime in July here in Wisconsin, and you're sitting outside, maybe around a campfire, and I want you to tell me, what are some of the things that you might hear if you were at nighttime outside? Yeah, what's something you hear? Crickets, yeah, what else might you hear? You could hear mosquitoes buzzing right by your ear if they were doing that. What else might some of the things you hear outside in the middle of the night? Yeah, go ahead. You could hear bees at night, you could, yeah. What are some of the things you might hear? I by our house, we've got a pond or a marshy area across the street, and I hear the frogs chirping, yeah. And sometimes I hear this, I hear a bird going, lots of things you hear. If it's a fire, maybe you'll hear the fire crackling, or you could hear the howl, the hoot of an owl going, ooh, have you heard those? All sorts of things you might hear. Now, I'm going to change. I got to show you a couple things here. So what do I got here? Yeah, that's my cell phone. That's right. And with my cell phone, I can call people, and I can talk with people and listen to people, right? And what do I got? What do I have here? What is this? Yeah, it's a music player, CD player. So I can put music on it, or this is what I sometimes really like to do. I like books, but sometimes I can't read the books, so I've got this. It's called a CD, and it's got the entire story of that book on there, and I could put it in that machine, and then I can listen. Yeah, expensive, but more important, then I can listen to the story. Now, I'm going to tell you all of this stuff because there's a difference between hearing and listening. Did you know that? There's a difference between hearing and listening. So if you're just hearing sounds, that's just hearing, right? Like I can hear the crickets, or I hear the fire, or the mosquitoes. Those are sounds around me, and I hear those, and you hear those. But when it comes to listening, listening is hearing, but it's also understanding and believing and doing the things you're hearing. So like if your mom or your dad says, it's time to wash your hands, and you don't wash your hands, are you really listening?
No,
that wouldn't be listening at all. Or if your mom or your dad said, it's time to go to bed, and you just keep running around, is that listening? No, you heard, but you didn't listen. Now, we've got something to listen to from God. And we listen to this, that he loves us very much in Jesus. There isn't anything that God would never forgive. We maybe don't listen to other people. Maybe we do the things that are wrong. And that makes people sad. It makes God sad. But we know that he loves us so much in Jesus. He always forgives us of all the things. And we listen for that. And because we believe it, we understand it, we also can trust that that's exactly what God says. It means he forgives, he forgives. And I tell you that because we just read about two people in the Bible who weren't very good at listening to God. That priest Amaziah and that king Herod, they did not listen to the promises that God made. They could hear the words, but they wanted nothing to do with God. But we're going to hear about how God wants everything to do with us. So Jesus, our Savior, tells us the most important gift that any of us can have. He loves us, and he forgives us, and he takes away all of our sins. You know, some of you have been in a chapel with me before at preschool, and there's one thing we always start with, and I do it at Sunday school too. I say we got to remind ourselves of the most important thing that Jesus tells us, that he loves us. So let's do that right now. We'll close with that. Take your pointer finger, point it to the sky, and then we're going to put that finger on your heart, and you're going to make a cross shape, and you're going to say, I am loved by Jesus. Are you ready? I am loved by Jesus. And you listen to that, because that's exactly what he teaches us. So let's put our hands together, and we'll do a repeat after me prayer. And I thank you guys for coming, so we'll pray with me. We'll ask the whole church to pray to you. Lord God, you give us ears to hear. But help us to also listen, to believe, and to trust all you promise us, that we are loved by Jesus. In his name we pray. Amen. Thank you all very much for coming up. Jesus bless your worship. grace and peace to you from our Savior, Jesus. Amen. And the word that God has today to engage us is that story from Mark 6. It's not a great story to end with, the beheading of John, but from it we're going to hear what God does for us as he takes us out of the haunting memory holes that sometimes we find ourselves in. And so as we get ready to begin, I just invite you to join me in this word of prayer. Lord God, may the words of my mouth and may the meditations of our heart, may they be pleasing to you, Lord God, who are our rock and our Redeemer. Amen. I can hardly drive past Fresno State without feelings of guilt and shame. That's what a young lady by the name of Melissa Dancy wrote in her blog. She wrote, "In our town, everyone goes to Fresno's football games." She says, "Everybody does it. It's just what you do." And I did. While I was attending college, I went to every game. Well, at least I went to every tailgate before every game. I can't remember if I actually made it into every game. She said, "I was not a Christian in college. So I lived my life accordingly. I drank and I partied too much. And other stuff. Stuff that I wish to God I could take back. It seemed like a lot of fun at those games, in those frat houses, on those streets. But now," she writes, "now those memories all carry shame." And here's what she posted. This is what she said. She said, "I know that Christ has forgiven me, but sometimes I struggle to believe it." That's part of Melissa's story. Haunted by the memory of past sins. Haunted by the shame that it brings. Knowing Christ's forgiveness, but struggling to believe it. The story that we read today from Mark 6 invites us to a similar place. It could be called the Palace Hall of Memories. There was a man named Herod who was plagued by the memory of an extraordinary sin, his extraordinary sin. Herod was a man who took delight in the extraordinary. Mark mentions that he loved to sit and he loved to listen to John. But when he was listening, he would be greatly perplexed, greatly disturbed, and his heart would get troubled, but he was ironically glad to listen to him. And Herod was a man who had ambitions of being a king, although he never received that title. He delighted in hosting extraordinary banquets. At one of them, you heard, he had a stepdaughter dance for his guests. And then he made this grand promise that he could never keep. He promised to give up to half of his kingdom, a kingdom he never possessed. And then this man, Herod, demonstrated an extraordinary faithfulness to his words of his promise. Because when his stepdaughter or her mother asked for the head of John, immediately Herod had the prophet beheaded and John's head delivered on a platter. Herod's delight in the extraordinary, his pleasure, his ambitions, his promises, they filled his life with a haunting sorrow and a haunting shame. That was his hall of memories. And at the same time, something truly extraordinary was happening in these lands. News was spreading throughout all the land of how the sick were being healed, about how evil spirits were being cast out of people, and people were returning to the Lord God in repentance and in faith. That was happening around him, but the palace of Herod's memory was haunting him. When he heard of Jesus and all that Jesus was doing, Herod's memory of his extraordinary yet sin-filled life troubled his mind. It haunted his heart. He was thinking to himself, all this is happening because John must have been come back to life. John's been raised from the dead to haunt me. That's what he's thinking. I thought I silenced John's voice when I beheaded him. But now all he can imagine is John coming back to haunt him in life. By the way, that's what shame does. Shame silences the living voice of God. Shame can be sometimes all that you hear. Think about Herod, and the thing about him is that he's an easy figure to dislike. I mean, he's loathsome. Dirty old man watching his stepdaughter dance. His sin is so extraordinary, it makes our failures seem like little infractions. And yet you know the truth. You know that God's judgment is clear, that all sin, no matter what it is, big, small, all is worthy of condemnation in his sight. Maybe we don't live in palaces. We don't give great banquets. We don't make outlandish promises. But I imagine that many of us are troubled by memories of our past, of our sin, haunted by our shame. Like Melissa's story, sin has a way of entering the most humble home and turning it into a place of torment. Oh, it's not beheading prophets. But you and I can be taunted and haunted and tormented by the memory of even extraordinary little sins. Every sin, no matter how small, from our perspective, every sin can still haunt our memories. And when that happens, it silences the voice of God. Or you come to worship on Sunday, you listen to God's word with pleasure, but you know what? When you fail to respond in faith to that word, you silence his voice. When you fail to put God's word into action and live according to his will, you silence the voice of God. You may not behead a prophet, but silence the voice of God, that you and I can do. When those sins haunt the halls of your memory, like they did for Herod and like they did for Melissa, you silence the voice of God. There's that one word that you spoke to tear somebody else down that now you wish you could take it back, but you can't. There's that one night that you lost your purity. That one day, your temper lashed out at somebody dear to you and you caused them to be great pain. There's that one moment of weakness when you couldn't stand up for your friend or defend the one that you love. How we live in the halls of our memories. The regrets that haunt our memories that maybe cause sleepless nights, but even worse, would leave you trembling before the living God. That's what the shame does. It silences the voice of God. And yet, we don't need to despair. Nor do we need to freeze up in fear. Because in this story from Mark 6, God is also offering us a glimpse of an even more extraordinary event. Did you notice it? Did you notice that Mark sets this past sin of Herod within the context of what Jesus is doing at that very moment? Herod hears the reports of what Jesus is doing and what's happening in the name of Jesus. With one little reference, Mark leads us into something as big as God working for the salvation of the whole world. Jesus is releasing it at that moment. Do you see the irony in this? Mark surrounds the story of Herod's extraordinary sin and shame with an even greater story of God's extraordinary love. Jesus has just sent out his 12 disciples. Teams of two, they go out. And they're taking the message of salvation that God brings in Jesus. They take Jesus' authority to cast out spirits, to heal people. They are bringing this life-giving message to the villages of how God gets things done when Jesus is in their midst. And all that time, Herod stands trembling and frozen in the hall of his past memories. And Jesus steps out in an extraordinary love to change the world. Jesus is going to go into those troubled places, and he's going to challenge people with the call to repent, to return to the God who is abounding in love. He calls people to turn away from what they've done wrong, to be forgiven, to be restored in this extraordinary act of God's mercy and grace and love. While Herod wallows in the misery of his sinful memories and shame, Jesus is out changing hearts and minds and souls with the offer of God's mercy, all through the work of Jesus, an undeserved favor that comes as a gift. And although Herod missed this extraordinary work of God, we don't. Regardless of what sin you brought into this place of worship today, you have come into a place of God's life-changing love. There's this simple truth that you need to hear today and every day. There is no sin that can separate you from the love of God. And it's true, no sin is so small for God not to notice. True, every sin is worthy of God's condemnation, every one. And perhaps you stand this day before the Holy One, and perhaps you're standing there haunted by those memories of your past sin, your shame. And yet, Jesus enters into those troubled places of our lives. Jesus carried the weight of God's punishment. He carried the weight of God's anger for those sins. He's paid the price already. Jesus exchanged his perfect life for our wretched lives. And in taking those sins upon himself, Jesus does the one thing that you and I cannot do. He sets us free. And while Herod feared that John the Baptist, whom he killed, had come back to life and now was haunting him, you and I rejoice that God raised from the dead the one that we crucified. And that through Jesus, that risen one, God's alive. And he enters your life with his love, no strings attached. And he brings his newness of life to you, no strings attached. And that's the memory that God says he never wants any of us to forget. I want to do this. I want to take you back to the rest of the story of Melissa. It didn't end where she just struggles knowing God's forgiveness. Because I think her story mirrors our story. This is what she was writing in her blog. She went on to write, she says, "I look back on my days in college and I honestly can't believe some of the stuff that I've done. I should be dead," she wrote. "And I'm not exaggerating in the least. The amount of stupid choices I made, mixed with alcohol, lowered inhibitions and incoherence. I can't believe I'm alive." But you know what's harder to believe? She says, it's harder to believe that I am redeemed. It's harder to believe that I'm forgiven and that I'm free. "There are days when my past comes back to haunt me," she said. "I know that Christ has forgiven me, but sometimes I struggle to believe it. And the enemy whispers those memories to me every time. Every time there's a football game," she says, "the enemy whispers to me those memories. He's there trying to silence the voice of God. I haven't stepped foot into that stadium for 7 years because of it. I feel like that sin is fresh in my life every time I drive by it. And there are days I still carry the weight and the guilt and the shame of it all. Until I remember God's good news for me." And this is what she said. "That Christ knew me on my worst day and still loved me. That Jesus saw my sin and he bore my shame. That Jesus welcomed me in, dirty, sinful, bruised, and broken. And although I hate driving past that football stadium, in the same way, it brings me hope. I know that there are places and memories and secret sins that we all have to come back to haunt us. But I'm reminded by the stench of my past. Even more, I'm reminded of the aroma of Christ's love for me is even greater." Passing down memory lane makes me grateful, she said, "for the present and hopeful for the future. Because now I know there is no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus." That is the rest of Melissa's story. And since there is the rest of the story for each of you too, let me finish with that. This is the good news for you. This is the good news for me. As the devil, the enemy, tries to take you down the hall of memories, as he tries to silence the voice of God within you, do this. Trust Jesus. Trust his message that in Jesus and through Jesus, God has more forgiveness than you have sin. And so now I ask you, does your past ever come back to haunt you? Do you at times struggle to rest in God's forgiveness because of those haunting halls of memories and shame? Let's take those memories captive and replace them with this truth, that if the Son sets you free, you're free indeed. And may that powerful memory of God's extraordinary love in Jesus for you be what captivates you this day and every day forward. Amen. And may the peace of God that does transcend all understanding be the peace that guards your hearts, guards your minds, in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen. With that, I'd like to invite our ushers to come forward as we worship our God by bringing our offerings before him. And if you have those care cards, you can place those in the offering plates as well.
Thank you.
Valentine's Day, I invite you to stand with one another and share with one another the faith that we have in our God and all that He has done for us. And again this morning, using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty,
Creator of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day He rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven, and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence He will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
We join together in praying for the whole people of God in Christ Jesus and to pray for all people in their needs. Lord God, You are so powerful and wise, and yet You are loving and good and gracious. We trust that Your mercies are new every day, for every day You open Your hand, You continue to provide for the needs of all Your children on earth. God, we praise You for every grace and blessing that we have received. Lord, in Your mercy. And Lord, You know the message that You have us tell is the story of salvation in Jesus. We pray that that message could be told to troubled souls everywhere. We pray that You continually use us in any way, our ministries, our offerings, all that we bring before You to extend that healing and hope to many. Lord, in Your mercy. We thank You for the voice of Jesus that overwhelms the enemy. Help us to trust and to hear that voice and not let shame and sorrow and sin silence Your voice of love and forgiveness. In our own walk of faith, help us to keep our eyes fixed on You and trust that there is nothing that can separate us from the love that You have for us in Christ Jesus. Lord, in Your mercy. God, we today pray also for our land. Heavenly Father, You are the God of all peace. It's Your gracious will that all Your children on earth live together in that harmony and peace. After yesterday's violent attacks, Lord, we pray very boldly that You would defeat the plans of all those who would stir up violence and strife. God, destroy the weapons of those who delight in war and bloodshed. And according to Your will, we pray that You end the conflicts in our world and the divisions in our land. Lord, in Your mercy. And Lord God, teach us also to examine our own hearts, that we may recognize every inclination toward envy and malice and hatred within us. Help us by Your word and spirit to search out our hearts, to root out the evil that would lead to strife and discord, so that in our lives we may be at peace with all people. And God, fill us especially with the zeal for Your work of the church and the telling of the good news of Jesus. That is alone the good news that can bring peace that's beyond all understanding. Lord, in Your mercy. You are our refuge and our helper, God, in every trouble and trial. We pray today that You would be with those who are hurting and suffering in mind and body and soul. We pray for those who call upon You, Lord, for healing and restoration. Be with Lisa Pagel as she continues, Lord. Grant her healing and restoration from her injuries. We give You praise and thanks, Lord, for the successful effective surgeries for Butch Owen and the treatment for Terry Lidke. Continue, Lord, to grant them Your favor and healing. Be with Nikki and Carla as they continue to receive treatment to drive disease from their body. And with those, Lord, who are under care towards the end of their days, be with them. With Natalie Rickman, Lillian Hildebrand, and Perry Thomas. Hold before them the hope that we have in Jesus, and give them the courage to face whatever comes their way with her hope in You. Lord, in Your mercy. Now into Your hands, Lord, we commend everything and everyone we pray for, trusting in Your mercy through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives, who rules with You and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. And hear us as we pray in Jesus' name and as He has taught us. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be Thy name.
You have safely brought us to the beginning of this day.
Defend us in the same way, and grant this day we fall into no sin, we neither run into any kind of danger, but that all our enemies, being ordered by your loving will, may be righteous in your sight, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
And receive this good word. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with his favor and give you peace. Amen. Just a reminder that we're going to be doing our tutorial. We'll start in about 5 minutes, so if you want to stay in, just stay in. If you want to come out.